leading men, those prime examples of masculine charm and appeal that women love and men like to copy.
Ladies, I give you Tommy Lundy, the man who makes America unsafe for women.
What is it about these fellows? Is it the way they sweep girls off their feet like George Siegel? The way they perform almost impossible feats of heroism like Tyrone Power? Or their fearlessness in the face of danger like Henry Fonda?
In the first place, Jesse, I just want you to understand I ain't as scared of you and I ain't as scared of your guns.
Maybe it's the way they make every man in the audience believe that he, too, could perform as well if just given the chance. Whether on the battlefields of war... or love.
That's for all the times I've wanted to break your neck.
In the mid-20s, America's romantic idol was Rudolph Valentino. 50 years later, it's the macho appeal of Burt Reynolds. Totally different kinds of men? Well, maybe not. The basics remain the same. It's all a matter of style.
Now, really, who could ask for anything better than this? Rain on the roof and a beautiful girl to keep me warm.
There's the dignified charm of Gregory Peck. The no-nonsense approach of Clark Gable.
I only have one question, and I only want one answer.
The gentlemanly style of Ronald Coleman. And the sex appeal with a smile of Paul Newman. Each man with his own style, but with the same effect. All of them lighting up the screen with their star quality. The Fox men reach into the audience, filling every woman with desire and every man with a touch of envy.
With me in a picture, what could you see in another guy?
Rudolph Valentino, the most adored actor in the history of Hollywood. For millions of women all over the world, he was the storybook lover come to life. He was the fantasy Latin hero who excited the imagination of women with his gentle caresses and his laughing eyes. Valentino set the style for screen lovers. Most men may have found him hard to take, but a half a century after his death, women are still bringing flowers to his tomb. Would-be movie Romeos, take note. With the coming of sound came the need for actors with persuasive voices. The mellow voice of Ronald Coleman could make almost any woman melt. Rosalind Russell is the girl being Colemanized in Under Two Flags.
Well, perhaps it's not so dull. And it hasn't seemed long until... now.
Now.
After this, it will be endless. Ah, you see, the old trick. I'm playing on your sympathy.
A major weapon of the leading man is voice. Listen as Richard Burton intrigues Lana Turner in The Reigns of Ranjapur.
In India, when a boy wants to tell a girl he's interested in her, he maneuvers his kite so that it falls into her front yard. If she picks it up and takes it inside, he is elated because he knows he has a chance. If she leaves the kite there, it means that she cares nothing for the boy and he is desolate. One needs to know a great deal about handling a kite to cause it to fall into the correct front yard.
Are you good at flying kites?
I have never flown a kite. I never had time to learn how.
In the early years of 20th Century Fox, no leading man did more to make the studio successful than this one. Tyrone Power, possibly the most handsome of all the stars and the idol of multitudes of women. In 1936, age 22, Power was given a small role in Girls' Dormitory.
What will it take to cheer you up? A diamond bracelet? A million francs? Or a dance with me?
I don't feel like dancing.
Have a drink of champagne. Or maybe I could entertain you with a few card tricks.
He was immediately put under long-term contract and starred in a series of highly commercial pictures in a variety of roles, but always stressing his own charming personality. In Son of Fury with Gene Tierney, he was a South Seas adventurer. In The Black Swan, he was a pirate. A musician in Alexander's ragtime band. A bullfighter in Blood and Sand. He was the famous outlaw Jesse James.
Count three and duck.
No! Jesse!
In A Yank in the RAF, Power was a fighter pilot and a submarine commander in Crash Dive.
Fire one. Fire one.
No matter the role, what the public wanted to see was Tyrone Power. When he was inducted into the service in 1942, the newsreel cameras were there to record the fact.
Tyrone Edmund Power.
And they were there along with his wife, Annabella, 3 years later when he came home.
Portland, Oregon, she sees him. Lieutenant Tyrone Power, the 20th Century Fox motion picture star, is welcomed home by his wife after war and battle as a Marine Corps pilot.
Like most returning stars, Power wanted to prove himself an actor in more mature parts.
Slowly shifting their form, visions come.
The critics praised his fine performance as the derelict in Nightmare Alley. The public just wouldn't buy it.
You're pretty good.
Hey, see how easy it is to hook him?
And back went Power to being the popular hero. His romantic image at Fox was masterminded by Daryl Zanuck. The star and his boss were good friends and often played practical jokes on each other. Power, for example, liked to take a daily dive into a pool heated to 52 degrees. Zanuck one day lowered the temperature to near freezing. Here's how Power got back at him. By filming this mock scene in The Mark of Zorro and slipping it into a screening without Daryl Zanuck's knowledge.
That's him.
This time, Excellency, I take only your money. Next time...
Zanuck.
And let that be a lesson to you, damn it. Adios.
And then, of course, there was Clark Gable, the king. Men admired him, women idolized him. Why? Watch this scene with Loretta Young in The Call of the Wild.
I want to starve in a garret, wear me hair long, get egg on a flowing tie. In other words, be a genius. But no. No, the world sneers at me talent, and instead it gives me gold.
Oh, my poor boy.
Gable never claimed to be a dedicated actor. He just played himself. And even the greatest actors envied him that rare ability. It's unique, and it's largely what being a movie star is all about. Today's Gable is Burt Reynolds, who combines sex appeal with a cheeky sense of humor.
Anybody ever tell you how cute you are?
Add a certain boyishness and a physical presence, and you have an actor who can pretty well write his own ticket.
Dashing, maybe. But cute. Never.
In 100 Rifles, it's Raquel Welch trying to get Bert on her side.
Well, do you bring the rifles?
Damn betcha.
Well, I'll send you.
Where are the rifles, Joe?
Well, the Chilina Trail. Not too far from here.
Well, I hope so.
There.
And where is the profit for you, Joe?
There ain't none, Sarita. Look, you told me to get the rifles, and I got them. What are you being so tough on me for?
Because I know you.
And in Lucky Lady, it's Liza Minnelli finding it impossible to turn the roguish bird away.
Excuse me, I didn't know you were undressing. I'll wait up on the deck.
Walker! You've seen a lot more of me than my bare feet before. What do you want?
I'm going to be sleeping up on the deck, and I just came down to get some of my things.
Go ahead, then.
Just get my jacket. And, might get a little cool, so... Take a blanket. Up there. I think a pillow. Because I get my head up against those boxes and Shaving. Well, I got my hat to keep my ears warm. Can't think of anything else.
Walker.
Hmm?
Would you rather sleep down here tonight?
Keep that light burning, Liza. We'll be back in a moment with Gregory Peck, Henry Fonda, and Paul Newman.
I'm a busy man, and I've got a lot on my mind. And for the last time, I tell you, there is no other woman.
Oh, I'm so sorry. We're waiting for you to go to the races. Oh, yeah?
Spencer Tracy, a man's man, whose flippant way with the ladies made him a hard catch and a challenge. The lady who most liked to meet that challenge was quite often Katharine Hepburn. Both had a touch of magic. Together, it became a special magic.
Tell me, Skipper, why have you never married? Don't you like women?
Oh, yes, sure, I like women. Specifically, as a sex, and specifically.
But not specifically enough to get married?
Oh, no, that's not it at all. I just never found anyone willing to put up with me.
That's why your socks never match.
My socks match today. Look.
What? So they do.
Sure. And they have matched for some time. You just haven't noticed it.
Oh.
More champagne?
One of the most successful films of recent times, The Omen, starring Gregory Peck, here with Lee Remick, as an American ambassador to England. Such a part calls for an actor with authority, dignity, and charm. In other words, a Gregory Peck. Career began in 1944, and throughout his unusually long period of stardom, and no matter what part he has played, it's his own basic qualities of charm and strength that have carried him with consistent appeal. That appeal was apparent even in his first Fox picture, The Keys of the Kingdom.
What is it?
Nothing.
Tell me.
You won't come home to me.
Laura.
And if you do, you'll go away again to the seminary with Angus.
Please. Why don't you just wait and see?
I'll try.
In David and Bathsheba, Susan Hayward asks a leading question.
David, did you really kill Goliath?
After seeing me with that sling, how could you doubt me?
Was he truly as big as they say?
Well, I will admit that he grows a little bit bigger every year.
Whether as King David or the harried Air Force General of 12 o'clock high, Gregory Peck has that essential quality, authority.
You know me, soldier?
No, sir.
Then why are you admitting me to this station?
I thought it was a staff car, sir.
Goering could have been in it. There's my AGO card.
General may proceed, sir.
Soldier, this is a military post, not a zoo. From now on, you'll check everyone who enters, and without exception. Take a good look at me. If you or any man on this post passes me up again without saluting, even if I'm a block away, you'll wonder what fell on you. You might pass that word around.
Yes, sir.
In Yellow Sky with Ann Baxter, Gregory Peck demonstrates another essential of the leading man, how to please a lady.
I paid for it.
Charming though he may be, a leading man will survive the years only if he's believable. And it's not simply a matter of being a good actor. It's that plus an image that makes him different. In Henry Fonda's first film, the 1935 The Farmer Takes a Wife, co-starring Janet Gaynor, he registers his unique image as the American everyman.
Miss Larkins, will you marry me?
What?
It's about getting married.
You like me, don't you?
Yes, ma'am, I've got to say I do.
In 1942, Fonda is the magnificent dope, proposing to Lynn Barry and revealing those qualities of bashful warmth and honesty that make him an irresistible leading man.
Hazel, I love you. Ever since that first day I arrived, I've wanted you more than I've ever wanted anything in all my life. I know it's sudden, but do you like me?
Yes, Ted, a lot. An awful lot.
I'm glad of that. Wouldn't have been much fun if it was just one-sided.
I don't know whether I love you.
Well, I didn't expect you to know right off. It even took me a few hours.
And in 1959, Fonda, with Leslie Caron, is still bashfully proposing and still intriguing the ladies.
You've been as much a part of me as my eyes, my arms, the very breath I breathe. What would you say that was?
I don't know with you.
Why not with me?
Because I don't understand you.
I've got a confession to make to you, darling. I'm really a very old-fashioned fellow.
A generation later, it's George Segal offering his leading ladies boyish charm, a wry sense of humor, and...
lots of class. That's my style.
Watch as George makes a play for Goldie Hawn and the Duchess and the Dirtwater Fox.
You're a very juicy-looking little lady. What do you think is my most attractive feature?
That's a tough decision.
Take your time.
Some
ladies like one thing, some another. It's all there.
Your jaw.
Funny, most ladies like my hair. They like to run their fingers through it.
Your jaw.
I remember once in St. Louis, there was this lady got her hand caught in there, wouldn't take it out for a day and a half. You about through?
With Paul Newman, the movies found the ideal contemporary leading man. Newman not only has the traditional charisma of the Tracys and the Gables, but he also relates to the realistic attitudes of today's audiences. He combines great ability as an actor with that indefinable quality, that mystique that makes an actor a star. Any woman will stop to give a lift to a man like that.
Do you like a lift to town?
Never walk when I can ride.
push him out of your way?
Yes, ma'am.
In Rally Round the Flag, it's Joan Collins giving Paul a lift and supplying a little temptation.
The whole problem is there just aren't any eligible bachelors in Putnam's Landing. Of course, the joint is absolutely jumping with married men. I could think of any one of them. Thing. Anytime I wanted to.
Oh, don't point that thing at me. I'm a happily married man. I have a happy home and a happy wife and two happy children. I couldn't be happy. I'm very happy indeed. If someone were unhappy, you could certainly make them happy. I mean, you're very attractive. Gosh, you sure do smell good. But don't you think you better watch where you're going?
A good point. A leading man must always watch where he's going, especially when playing a rascal like Butch Cassidy. The ladies, Catherine Ross in this instance, like men who can amuse them as well as love them. A leading man becomes a leading man by getting up there on the screen and showing the rest of us how to win the girls, beat the bad guys, and keep the establishment in line. And that's what the Fox men do. They amuse, they inspire, and they help build up our confidence. If you have a lot of confidence, you can even show off your bicycle tricks. Oops. Well, even the best of leading men can't be right all the time. Sorry, Paul, but that's Hollywood.